This is one of the greatest Dutch achievements. They're the world's largest exporter of plants, the second largest of cheese, and in Europe, they're the biggest exporter of meat and vegetables. Altogether, this makes them the second largest agricultural exporter in the world after the United States, but while using just 0.5% of their farmland. But that might soon change.
Het systeem van onze hele landbouw, dat is failliet.
Ingrijpende plannen die de hele sector raken. Er heerst grote onrust op het platteland.
The Netherlands is in emergency mode. Thousands of construction projects are cancelled. And farmers are no longer allowed to grow their business.
Omdat er simpelweg niet net te veel, maar veel te veel stikstofuitstoot is.
The downside of being the world's most efficient farmers in Europe's most densely populated country is that the emissions of nitrogen and ammonia are also higher than anywhere else on the continent. This cloud of pollution was ignored for decades, but in 2019, the Council of State ruled that this was illegal. The country went into lockdown, and politicians quickly laid the blame on farmers. But are they really the ones at fault? How did the Dutch pull off their incredible agricultural success? And is it really necessary to drastically shrink this industry? This is Dutch agriculture with hindsight. I've been working on hindsight for about 1.5 years, and my goal is to combine storytelling with the news to create videos that provide some context to the world that we live in. I always publish all of my scripts with all of the sources, and I'm constantly trying to increase my awareness of my own biases. I'm a one-man team, and this month in September, I'm gonna be on holiday. I'm gonna be visiting my family who live all over the world, and that means that I'm not gonna be publishing every single week. If you want to support me making these videos more frequently and with higher quality, I recently opened a Patreon page where you can support me with a donation for as little as $2 per month. I'll put up a link in the description and in the pinned comment in case you want to check it out. And now, let's go back to the video. Little over half of the Netherlands is farmland, and this sector employs nearly 200,000 people. The worth of agricultural exports is increasing, partly due to higher prices, and a significant percentage is made up of re-exports. These are products that are imported in the Netherlands, sometimes processed, and then exported to foreign markets. The Netherlands has exceptional infrastructure. Rotterdam is the biggest port in Europe, and Schiphol is the busiest airport by aircraft movement. And the country is located in the delta of two major rivers, and on the trade route from Southwest Europe to the UK and to the Baltics. The rest of their exports consist of locally produced products, of which dairy and eggs, horticulture, which includes tulips, meat and vegetables are the largest. It is remarkable that a small country that is so densely populated can produce food items at this scale. But it wasn't always like that. Dutch farmers in the mid-19th century were already twice as productive as farmers in Germany and France. Much of their land was too wet and marshy for farming, and was drained using windmills. The soil this exposed was very silty, and in many places only grass would grow. So they specialized in raising livestock, producing butter, milk, and cheese. The Dutch government played a significant part in the sector's growth. They built canals, which made for cheap transport, and they facilitated access to export markets in London and later in Germany. The gains of these exports were often reinvested in technology, which spread informally between farmers. One farmer saw his neighbor do something better and would copy that, but that changed in 1876. The state founded Wageningen University, the first national agricultural education. They also started a program of wandelleraren, walking teachers, who worked in the field to convince farmers to adopt the latest technology. The strategy of the Dutch was to overproduce, export, and then invest in technology to keep a competitive edge. But during the World Wars, their preferred export markets closed, and there was a shortage of everything. A disaster was about to happen. The Allied forces had landed in Normandy and they were rapidly gaining terrain. By September, they reached the Dutch border and they dropped tens of thousands of soldiers deep behind enemy lines. The operation had some initial successes, but after 2 weeks, the offensive was brought to a standstill. The Dutch railways and many Dutch citizens had cooperated with the Allies, and the Germans wanted to punish them, so they placed an embargo on food imports. It was October, and unusually cold for the time of the year. The cold winter made for a poor harvest, and a lack of fuel and cars made it difficult to distribute what farmers had. Food was rationed at 1,000 calories per day in the beginning, but this was lowered to a little over 500 calories by February. The famine killed over 20,000 people, and this became known as the Hunger Winter. This is where the story of Dutch modern agriculture starts. The Hunger Winter changed the Dutch attitude towards food security. The message from politicians to farmers was clear: scale up and intensify. But the problem was that the Netherlands was already a very densely populated country. In 1950, there were 10 million people, and by 1980, there were 14 million. There was an increased demand for food, and the available land was shrinking. The only way that this industry could grow is if their farmers would become more efficient. So guess what they did? They became frontrunners of greenhouses, and they kept more animals in less space. Between 1950 and 1980, the number of cows increased substantially, while better technology increased the average milk production per cow from over 4,000 kilograms per year to nearly 8,000 kilograms per year. The government stimulated larger farms to absorb smaller ones, and instead of producing a variety of products, to be highly specialized. All of this led to the agricultural output to grow with 60% by 1980. But this increased scale and intensity also started showing a downside.
In een kilometerslange kolonne trokken ze over de A28 naar het zuiden. De stemming onder de boeren was grimmig.
Wij worden nu voor de zoveelste keer verneukt, zeg maar. En de maat is vol.
There were increasing concerns over particularly the pollution of fertilizer and manure and how this was affecting the environment, soil and the quality of drinking water. On top of that, there was an overproduction of some products like milk. And this led the Dutch government and the European Union to place restrictions on the sector. This was the beginning of a new phase, the transition to sustainable farming. We are still amidst this phase, and it's changing the relationship between farmers and the government. The period from 1880 to 1980 was characterized by modernization and growth. And the government and the EU helped farmers grow their business and become wealthier. But from 1984 and onwards, the government was factoring in sustainability. The number of cows in the Netherlands was cut almost in half over just 14 years. And the number of people working in agriculture dropped by over 50% in the 1980s and 90s. This led to many farmers' fear for their livelihood. The focus shifted over the years, but the topic of nitrogen pollution was well known since the early 1990s. Nitrogen is emitted by almost everything: the industrial sector, cars, and aircrafts. But the agricultural sector is by far the biggest polluter. This nitrogen resurfaces, amongst other places, in protected nature reserves. It helps some plants to grow really fast and outcompete others. It reduces biodiversity and threatens native flora and fauna. This was a problem that they had to deal with. By 2010, the emissions were substantially lower, mostly because of sacrifices from the agricultural sector. But from 2010 and onwards, the emissions stayed more or less the same. In 2019, this changed. The Dutch Council of State ruled that the Dutch policies about allowing emissions was unlawful, and this meant that thousands of construction projects had to be cancelled. The airport couldn't expand, roads couldn't be built. And farmers could equally not invest in growing their business. This pollution had to be dealt with first. Shortly after this ruling, this article was published. D66 wants to halve livestock. A politician from that party said, about 70% of the harmful nitrogen emissions in the Netherlands come from agriculture and intensive livestock farming. That is enormous. Meanwhile, the contribution of intensive livestock farming to the economy is less than 1%. That balance is completely off. But farmers disagreed. The morning of October 1st saw the busiest morning traffic in the history of the Netherlands. Farmers were heading to The Hague.
Met één pennenstreek, meer dan de helft van de boeren en hun beesten willen uitwissen.
Farmers already saw thousands of jobs disappear. A large part of their livestock was sacrificed. And since 1990, they had already reduced emissions from ammonia with 65%, nitrogen with 50%, and phosphate with 85%.
Er kan gerust iets veranderen, maar het moet wel niet alleen van onze kant komen, vind ik.
The agricultural sector is responsible for about half of nitrogen emissions, but many farmers felt that they were blamed for the entire problem. And just listen to politicians speak.
Een groot probleem dat we in Nederland hebben, namelijk het stikstofprobleem.
This is the Dutch Prime Minister.
Op korte termijn zorgt het er ook voor dat Nederland nu op slot staat. Waardoor wegenbouw, huizenbouw, andere grote projecten, trouwens ook projecten die nodig zijn voor de energietransitie, vertraging oplopen of soms zelfs niet kunnen doorgaan.
Pause. So the problem is road construction, housing construction and large projects that are needed for the energy transition. Okay, continue.
En tegelijkertijd moeten we er ook voor zorgen dat waar we weten dat de landbouw een belangrijke bijdrage levert aan die stikstof, dat er ook een toekomst blijft voor die sector.
You can sense that he's choosing his words carefully, but he's stressing that the agricultural sector is primarily responsible.
We zijn het helemaal zat.
Farmers felt that they were blamed for everything. But this was turning into a crisis that was emblematic for a growing disconnect between politicians and the people. In left-wing media, it's easy to find examples like this. Why do we actually have livestock farming? Which is trying to make the point that the country would look much more beautiful without this sector of the industry. And the author bases this on scientific analysis. Or this one. A quarter of the Netherlands is for cows, and they're destroying it. Making the argument that livestock farming isn't sensible. On top of this, in recent years, the government's handling of this transition was often poor. For example, in 2015, the end of the milk quota led many farmers to invest in keeping more cows. But shortly thereafter, new phosphate laws forced them to once again reduce their livestock. This added to the perception that the government was against farmers.
Ik ben hartstikke trots op onze sector. We hebben al zoveel gedaan. We zijn ook wel bereid om nog wat te doen. Maar nee, het moet niet gaan van jongens, alle boeren maar uit Overijssel weg. Nee jongens, daar kunnen we niet het gesprek meer aangaan.
He is actually from the same province as where I am from. And tomorrow I'm gonna visit my family who lives there. And the characteristic of this landscape is that you have small pastures, farms and small specks of forest. And farmers like him have an important function in maintaining this landscape.
A third of the Netherlands is used by livestock farmers, and a substantial part is used for raising crops. Farming is a lifestyle, a culture, and a set of values. It's part of the cultural heritage of the Netherlands, and a large number of people felt this way. In 2019, a new political party was formed called the Farmer Citizen Movement. And in 2023, they became the largest party in every province during the provincial elections. They are now part of the coalition and promise to do things radically different. It is important to realize that the Dutch agricultural sector is very broad and not the entire industry is affected by these issues. Public funding for research and development has tripled since the 1980s. And the Netherlands is on track to becoming a major food processor. Dutch farming in greenhouses is magnitudes better than in other parts of the world. Whereas on a hectare of land in 1950, they could grow 68 metric tons of tomatoes. By 2015, they were able to yield 7 times as much. This is still 5 times more than the average yield of an American farmer. And whereas on a global average, it requires 213 liters to grow a kilogram of tomatoes, the Dutch are using just 9 liters, compared to 127 liters in the United States. This isn't an outlier. The same goes for cucumbers, green peppers, and many other crops. The Dutch are using a fraction of the space, the fuel, and the water to grow their crops. And this skill will be in high demand in the future. The world population is expected to grow to 10 billion people in 2050. The amount of food that is needed for the next 4 decades is equal to what all farmers have harvested over the past 8,000 years. The Netherlands is at the forefront of agricultural development, and several sectors of the industry are currently thriving. But the future of primarily livestock farmers is much more uncertain. The number of people working in this sector has been reducing for decades, as a natural consequence of industrialization. But the sector doesn't have to end over emissions. The Dutch can and are trying to tackle this issue with technology. And many farmers are willing to adapt, but they just ask to be treated fairly. The Dutch agricultural success is often credited to 2 reasons: their location and their technology. But I want to argue that there is a 3rd reason: their ability to adapt. There's no other way that they could have stayed ahead of anybody else for so many centuries. The video here on the left talks about an important turning point in Dutch history, the discovery of the then largest gas field in the world. Consider it for your next watch.